Namaskar, good evening to you all. Welcome to Desi Plaza TV, and this is the episode for Face to Face with Dr. Prakash Rao. Thank you so much for joining, and today we are going to present a very beautiful, interesting story about the person who actually gave all of his life, his expertise, and spreading the word about Hinduism. Being thousands of miles away from our heritage, culture, and tradition, and our roots, we always struggle to keep up with it, teach that one to our kids. When kids ask us how, what, when those questions, we really, really try to find those answers. And to give those answers today, we really do have a person who knows all about it, and also we are going to learn through his knowledge, expertise about Hinduism. It gives me a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Prakash Rao Velagapudi, who is a very well-known personality in Dallas-Fort Worth area. He is not only a social worker, also he's a big contributor towards teachings of Hinduism. Thank you so much, Dr. Prakash Rao.
Thank you so much, and I really appreciate your words. Thank you.
Today's word, like I said, we really do struggle.
Yes.
And contributing this knowledge to us is not an easy thing.
Correct.
But before that, I would like to introduce you to our viewers.
Okay.
Please do tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay. You see, I came to United States in 1965. I went to Michigan State, received my master's degree, and then moved to Mississippi because there is a professor who was doing a lot of research on India. So I wanted to do PhD actually in Mississippi. And in 67, I moved to Mississippi to study and get my PhD. And at that time, so I met my future wife. She also came from India in 1967. That is where we met. We both received PhDs from the university. And then we spent almost 35, 36 years teaching in different universities, mainly in Jackson, Mississippi. That is where we settled before we moved to Frisco in 2009.
Before the Mississippi, what brought you here to United States?
You see, that was it's a God's grace, I would say. You see, I mean, to tell you frankly, at least I cannot generalize anybody. I grew up in a very small village. I did not have much knowledge about anything. We are talking about 1965. And so I was not sure so whether there are some countries where they will support your education and all that. So after I received my master's degree in Andhra Pradesh, so I went to New Delhi. I was working with one gentleman, Koneru Radhakrishnamurthy, because he also followed Kakani Venkatratnam, who is from our village. So he asked that gentleman to take me to Delhi and then find a job. So I worked for him for about 1.5 years. Then he suggested, no, you cannot stay here in India. If you really want to know something about sociology and whatever you are interested, you have to go to United States. So I didn't even know how to even apply for it or anything. So he himself called his professor, because he received a PhD at Michigan State University. So he called his professor, got the application, and asked me to fill it up. I didn't even know how to do it, because there are some questions like, are you a veteran? Is the question. I didn't know a thing about what that means, so I didn't fill it up. Then he himself filled it up. He sent it to professor. He got an assistant for me. That is how I was basically divine force actually brought me here, not because I really wanted to learn something, not that I wanted to come to this country, but there are certain things beyond our control. And also, in everybody's life, there are some people who influence your future.
Absolutely.
Who direct you. Just with one word or one act, your whole life changes. I always remember gentleman, because he is the one who prompted me, encouraged me, and pushed me to come to this country. That is how I came to this country, sure. And then started our journey.
You also are a founder of a temple in Mississippi, and when we were talking earlier,
correct,
that we mentioned someone very important asked you a very critical question,
correct,
that every parent
correct,
get, like,
correct,
when can we go visit a church?
Correct.
Because
correct,
they hear from all the friends.
Correct.
So,
correct,
what was your answer?
You see, of course, like most Hindus, I would say, dare to say 90-95% of us don't have a clue about our religion. We cannot even speak one word about it. We have not read one book about our Hinduism. There was no formal transmission of knowledge in India to any of us. So as a result, so we just come here almost like robots. We don't know anything about it. We know we are Hindus, except that one that we don't know anything about it.
Sure.
And so then you get married and you have children, and the children, obviously, they go to school. Mm-hmm. And in fact, our children went to private school. And so my son was about 7-8 years of age. And one day he comes and says, Daddy, when are we going to church? So that really blew me off. I was shocked, actually, first of all. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how to even respond to that one. Mm-hmm. I was stunned. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about it. My wife and I discussed it to some extent. What is it that we can do? Mm-hmm. And so within a week or 10 days, we decided that we have to teach something about our religion to our children. But, you know, as I mentioned, we didn't know anything about religion. The only thing that I could think of at that time was Rajaji's Ramayana and Mahabharata. Those are the only two books that I know. So then we said, okay, let's go ahead and start Sunday school. I don't know how we got that word Sunday school, but somehow we got it. So we had about 10 students every week come. And then the only thing that I was doing is basically narrating the story of either Ramayana or Mahabharata. And then at that time, so I had a few books also collected based on that one. So I prepared the courses every week, this one. And over a period of time, the realization has come that we need to have some kind of a association with other Indians and see what is it that we can do as Hindus in order to promote and transmit the knowledge to our next generation. So, of course, there was an India Association already established. Mm-hmm. In India Association, so we thought we will have some kind of a committee, which we called Building Committee, and see if we can have a building where we can build and then start teaching all these classes. Also, celebrate our festivals, because we used to go to some church and other organizations and do Diwali and Navaratri, all those items. Then slowly it moved, and then so we started Hindu Temple Society of Mississippi. That was around 82-83. Mm-hmm. And till that time, so we went to actually Pittsburgh. By that time, there was a Balaji temple. Every year we used to go as a pilgrimage, actually, every summer. That was at least about 10 years we went there. And then around 83-84, we started the temple in Jackson, Mississippi itself. So at that time, we had probably 125-130 families. That's all we had in Jackson, Mississippi at that time. We are talking about 82-83. So then we assembled, and then we discussed it, and did what is it we can do. Mm-hmm. Shall we have a community hall or a temple? In the beginning, everybody felt that, you know, we need to have a community hall because there are other groups of people also. But within a year or so, we realized that there may be a conflict of interest in this one if we build only Hindu temple but not address the issues of other religions. So as a result, one of the lawyers advised us, either you build Hindu temple or you build India building. So don't mix it these two.
Sure.
Then we separated ourselves into Hindu Temple Society of Mississippi. Mm-hmm. And then we registered. And then we built about 10,000 square feet hall. And then within a year or so, we were able to complete that building. And then at that time, since we have only 120 families, so we need some support from everybody. In order to get support, what is it we have to do? Whoever suggests any god, we just included in the temple.
You
so we had 17 murtis in our temple in Jackson, Mississippi.
Okay.
So we never realized how difficult it is to manage with 17 murtis. We didn't know how many priests we needed at that time.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't know what is the difference between Vaishnavites and Shaivites and all that one.
Mm-hmm.
We just wanted to have a temple. That's all the ultimate goal. We didn't, none of us had any knowledge about how to manage it, how to operate it, what are the customs, what are the traditions, how many times you have to do. All those things we didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
So we evolved over a period of time.
Mm-hmm.
And then so we put all those 17 murtis actually in the temple.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was a big hall.
Mm-hmm.
And one side, so we have all these murtis.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is a big hall. So that is how we started the journey. Later on, people have realized that it is not really serving the purpose, and also it is not according to the shastras or the scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
Because this one is like a community hall with murtis rather than a temple with murtis.
Okay. Let me interrupt you in
yes.
right here. When
yeah.
you said community hall, so we do, I mean, we are used to going to temples in India with the gopuras and all those, aartis, and it has a very unique
correct.
Atmosphere, ambience
correct.
In that temple.
Correct.
So, what do you say? How important it is to have that ambience in the temple?
You see, it is very, very scientific.
Okay.
You see, the temple, according to all the scriptures and all the shastras, you have to have a temple with all the gopuras, and inside or in outside, it doesn't matter where it is,
mm-hmm.
you have to have it for a number of reasons.
Okay.
One,
mm-hmm.
you see, there is always in the gopurams, when you just look at the
mm-hmm.
Kalashas receive the vibrations from the sun and all the planets.
Uh-huh.
And those vibrations are passed down to the deities that are installed in the Garbhagudi.
Okay.
Also, temple is always compared with a human body.
Right.
There is no difference between a temple and a human body.
Okay.
All the parts, whatever parts that we see today in the human body, they are also replicated in the temple. So if you look at it, Rajagopuram
mm-hmm.
is like a feet.
Okay.
So generally when you have that traditional temple,
uh-huh.
so when you enter through Rajagopuram,
okay.
that means you touch the
mm-hmm.
Rajagopuram, that
okay.
means you are touching the feet. And then you come to the Dvajastambham.
Sure.
Dvajastambham is like recreation, creative type thing. And then you will also see next to it Dvajastambham
mm-hmm.
and Balipitam. So these are like male and female combinations actually.
Okay.
Dvajastambham and then Balipitam. And then you come into the temple, that is like our chest and our stomach kind of thing.
Okay.
And then you go to Ardha Mandapam, that is like a throat kind of thing. And then you go into the Garbhagudi, that is like our head. And then at the same time, if you see, most of the temples also have the side gopurams, east and west, west, north and south and all that. So when usually all the temples face, most of the, I would say not all, 90-95% of the temples face only east.
Okay.
When they face east, that means west side,
mm-hmm.
there will be a gopuram
mm-hmm.
that is like a tuft
mm-hmm.
of a human person.
Protection.
And then north and south also you will have the gopurams.
Okay.
They are like left and right hands. So
wow.
if you look at the whole, if you look at any human being laying down,
right.
so you have the head, you have the throat, you have the chest and the stomach, and then you have the knees, and you have the feet.
Okay.
All those things match exactly the way our people have done.
Mm-hmm.
So that means you need to have that kind of vibrations.
Right.
When you enter, you automatically you are supposed to feel the vibrations.
Okay.
At the same time, whenever a temple is constructed based on science, based on our Agama Shastras and Shilpa Shastras, so you need to have the priest who can actually chant daily mantras in order to create more vibrations. And so that way, if anybody who comes into the temple, they should feel those vibrations. The more they do pujas, the more they chant, more vibrations are created. So that's the reason whenever we go to temple, our main purpose of going is to have some kind of a peace of mind.
Okay.
I mean, that's all. Why do we want to go? Just because, even though we may not realize it, you want to have some peace of mind, reduce the stress. After 8 hours of whatever we do in this country, whatnot, you want to release this stress and stress. So you go to that one. You sit there for a few minutes. You meditate a little bit, or you listen to the chanting. So those chanting, the vibrations are enormous. Scientifically, it is proven. These mantras have so many benefits. When they chant, it will pierce through every pore of your body, every part of our body. It touches your heart. It touches your brain. It influences your brain. So that is the impact these mantras have. We don't realize it. If you look at the same thing, some people might say, well, you know, you can do puja at your home and whatnot. Yes, there is no question about it.
But the
benefits that you receive by visiting temples are definitely better than doing it at home.
That's a wonderful knowledge about, because a lot of us go to temple, but we have absolutely no clue about all these things. And thank you so much for sharing this one with us. And we will just continue this one with our next episode. And Dr. Prakash Rao is going to tell us the importance of, I'm going to ask him, with the importance of a bell, maybe what it does to us, and also much more. So stay tuned. Welcome back, and thank you for watching Desi Plaza TV. We are continuing our second episode with more information about Hinduism face to face with Dr. Prakash Rao. In the previous episode, we talked about the importance of temple, how it is compared to the body, and importance of mantras, and why and how and what is the main point that we definitely need to know about those things. So let's continue our conversation with Dr. Rao, and he is going to tell us about his spiritual journey. Welcome back, Dr. Rao. And this is really an interesting question. And how did you get into this? You know, what prompted you to get into this Hinduism? And also, how did you start your spiritual journey?
It's a very long story, but we will try to condense it into a few minutes. As I mentioned, so we built that temple. I was chairman of Hindu Temple Society of Mississippi until 1990. And we completed that building in 1988, actually.
Okay.
Then we were planning to do Kumbhabhishekam. So, but all the murtis were supposed to come from Tirupati, so they did not come on time. In 89, some gentleman from Baton Rouge called saying that there is a Swamiji from South India. His name is Ganapati Satchidananda Swamiji. Since you already completed the building, so would you like to have Swamiji visit your temple?
Sure.
So as I said, you see, we are totally ignorant of anything and everything about our role in our religion. That is unfortunate, but I think we are trying to change it, and hopefully we will change. So everybody has their own preconceptions about different things.
Sure.
So I had a lot of those things. So when he called me, said, so a particular Swamiji is there and whether I want to invite, I said, nothing doing. I don't like all these Swamijis. I have no respect for them, all kinds of words that he used, and said no. Within a year, So we invited Medasani Mohan. You know, most of the Telugu people know about it, 99% know. So he's Ashtavadani, Shatavadani, Sahasravadani, so on and so on. So I invited him to Thana in 1989. He stayed at our house for almost 15 days. We arranged these Ashtavadanams in about 15 places. At that time, he indicated that, you see, you are somewhat religious and I see what you are doing, but you have to meet Ganapati Sachidananda Swamiji. I said, you know, only last year I said nothing doing, so you say ask me to do. No, you see, I mean, everybody has their own
beliefs,
but he is a Sakshat Devudu, that means he is really a God man. You have to meet him because of your interest in the religion and all that. So I said, okay, then, you know, since I have so much respect for this Medasani Mohan, I said, okay, I will definitely do it. So the 1990, we were planning Kumbhabhishekam for Jackson Temple.
Sure.
So we wanted to just go ahead and get all the yantras blessed. So we sent it to Mysore. Swamiji was not there. So, but anyway, so then we brought all the yantras that are supposed to go under the pedestals of all
sure.
the gods. And all of a sudden in April, that is 1990, so we came to know that Sri Ganapati Sachidananda Swamiji was visiting US. So since our friend Medasani Mohan suggested that I should meet him, then I said, okay, let me call and find out whether he would bless these yantras, because we always get, they are blessed by Kanchi, Swamiji and all that. So I tried to call and then I found out that he was coming to Baton Rouge, so I need to go and visit him and take the yantras and see if he would bless. So I go there and then I went to the place where Ganapati Sachidananda was, Swamiji was staying, and within about 10-15 feet, so he was coming from other side of the house, and we just stopped the car and we are just going toward him. It's about 10-15 yards away from him.
Mm-hmm.
So we had eye contact.
Mm-hmm.
He looked at my eyes and I looked at my eyes. So, I mean, the whole body started just shivering.
Mm-hmm.
My hair stood up. I had perspiration. My heart was pumping like anything. My blood was gushing and I became numb. I started sweating heavily.
Okay.
So it could be just 1 minute, one second or 10 seconds, we don't know. At that time, so you don't realize the time. So once you are at that stage, time has no meaning actually. So it may have been only few seconds, but I feel that I did not know anything about my existence for few seconds.
Very mesmerizing.
So all of a sudden, so it happened that way. And then, so anyway, he just stood and he smiled and said, yes, Datta brought you,
mm-hmm.
you follow me.
Okay.
So we go to different places, and then on the way we go to somebody's house, and then they were doing Paduka Puja.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, you know, generally we didn't know about it. I said, you know, why they are doing puja to these chapels kind of thing, sandals? I mean, you know, if they are interested in,
mm-hmm.
you know, believe in Swamiji, they should do puja to him rather than to the sandals, because that is the level of understanding that I had. I didn't even know
mm-hmm.
the sandals had that kind of, the padukas have that kind of importance. I was
mm-hmm.
thinking they are all chapels kind of thing. And then, you know, he materialized something and gave it to those people. So I thought, you know, he's just bluffing. He just put it somewhere in his hand and he was giving, not, I don't think he really did it. You see, I have all the suspicions that anybody can have it.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes to another house and that is where he was supposed to do the bhajans.
Mm-hmm.
And then so he met a few minutes and we talked about our temple, what we are doing and all that. And then he came to a big hall like this one actually, and then he set up his instruments and all that. And then he asked one of his associates to explain what is the significance of these yantras, why they should be placed under the pedestal.
Mm.
So then Swamiji put all those yantras, all 17 yantras on his table.
Mm-hmm.
And then so he took one flower,
mm-hmm.
Rose flower, and then he started taking kumkum, a fistful of kumkum, and then he started putting on each of them. So there are 17 fistful of kumkums that he put took out from the rose, and then he put it, and then he gave us also. We still have some that kumkum. So at that time I realized this is not an ordinary person kind of thing, because you know there is no way you can have this kind of negative attitude, saying no, these are all humbug kind of thing and all that, when you see with your own eyes this kind of miracle. Then
so it was just the flower, nothing
yes,
else.
Just only flower, that's all. Okay. We are left hand, he has flower, and then he was just taking a fistful of it.
Wow.
So 17 like that, okay. One, and then he gave some to us. Okay. We still have it.
Okay.
Then he blessed us, and we went back to Mississippi. We did the prana pratishtha. The minute prana pratishtha was over, we started having problems. So I was chairman for about 6-7 years,
right.
And then I started having problems with the rest of the 8 members, and within 4-5 months it has come to the stage where I could not even take it any longer.
Okay.
And then I resigned actually as chairman of the temple. Then since that time, so I'm having a lot of obsession about Swamiji. Whether I am sleeping, whether I am driving, whether I am working, whether I am doing anything,
constantly thinking about
as if he is pushing me, he is guiding me, kind of thing. I said, why?
You
meet so many people in life. Why this guy is doing something like this to me and all that? You know, this is the thinking that we have.
Sure.
And so then I thought, you see, probably I may have a mental problem. I am not able to control my brain, or
emotions.
He may have done black magic. These are the two things probably in my mind. So, but you know, you are too proud to go to a psychiatrist and say you have mental problem and all that. So then I started reading books about any book I can find. Find out whatever experience that I had when I met him, and then why I have this kind of obsession with him.
Sure.
So I read so many books. I couldn't find the answer. Finally, there is a book. It is called The Only Dance There Is.
Okay.
It is written by Richard Alpert. He was a Harvard University professor who was fired because he was doing some smoking about marijuana and all that at that time. Then he goes to India, he finds a guru, and guru touches him on his forehead, and then he falls on the floor. Then they sprinkle the water, and then 15 minutes he gets up. Then he wrote an experience, what happened when he touched his forehead.
Sure.
That experience and my experience exactly matched.
Okay.
Then he also said, when is a guru, Sadguru like that one, if he blessed you with this kind of experience, that means they have something in mind.
Correct.
They are trying to see that your body and mind and everything is cleaned, purified, so cleansed. So that's the reason they will make you to experience this mental churning. And that is what. Then I realized at that time, till that time I was trying to remove him from my image, from my mental image. All of a sudden I felt, oh, there is something in it. Anyway, so then I realized this is his divine wish that I follow him, kind of thing. The minute I realized it, I thought I want to see him. Till that time I didn't want to see his face.
You did not even believe
in Swamiji. Exactly.
Okay.
Then it happened that he was in Trinidad at that time.
Okay.
Within 3 days we just flew to him.
Sure.
And then so we met him, and he smiled, and we had a very big, very good meeting. And so then the minute I saw him, I started crying. So that crying actually started and then continued for 5 years. Every time I saw Ganapati Satchidananda Swamiji, for 5 years, I used to cry.
So the cry was like out of emotion?
It just comes. It just comes.
Okay.
You don't make
like
any
tears in your eyes.
You don't even make any effort.
Sure.
And my wife used to say, why you cry? I don't understand what is happening to you and all that.
Maybe
kind.
It's out of happiness.
Exactly, happiness. And then all of a sudden, then he comes, actually, we invited him to come to Jackson, Mississippi, because in 1993, he was planning to have a world tour for conducting all these healing and meditation music.
Okay.
So we invited him to Jackson, Mississippi. He came in 1993. And then, so at that time, so he appointed me as a chairman of Dutt Yoga Center.
Okay.
And at that time, he also mentioned, so, do you now know why you left Hindu temple? Because
there
is a purpose. So there is a purpose. I purposefully created a situation for you to leave the temple because I wanted you to be part of my organization. Nobody will think anything about you, bad about you, because you have done what you are supposed to do. Now your mission is to take care of this Dutt Yoga Center kind of thing. That is how our journey started, and we experienced so many miracles actually in our life also.
Mm-hmm.
And then as a chairman, so we have actually Dutta Retreat Center in Pittsburgh. So usually I go once a year kind of thing, and just to look at the things, what is happening kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then around 1996,
mm-hmm.
so Swamiji actually built one Dutta Temple in Baton Rouge. So I was also part of that one in the planning and construction and all that. And then in 2007, Swamiji called everybody in Baton Rouge, said that I have an interest in establishing Hanuman Temple.
Okay.
Hanuman Temple. So that is what I want you to undertake this particular project. And so all of a sudden, so the new project has come. So 2008, so we bought this land and then we started this one.
But before now, we go into the details of that, no. I wanted to also know this Dutta Center also has a several way of teaching.
Correct.
Like satsang.
Correct.
To other devotees.
Yes.
Who are interested.
Yeah.
In.
Yeah.
So
see, this is a very important thing actually at that time. Because their communication was not as great as it was. We are talking about 25 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So our mission at that time was, how do we spread Swamiji's music and bhajans? Because Swamiji has composed more than 7,000 songs.
Mm-hmm.
It is all instantaneous. He never sits and writes in one place. And also about probably 35 years ago, he experimented about the impact of this healing music. Since he is singing frequently, and then he is using all the instruments,
mm-hmm.
then one gentleman from Germany, he goes to Mysore
mm-hmm.
with cancer, and he asks Swamiji that I have cancer, I went to Europe all over the place, but nothing has happened, can you help me? Swamiji thought about it and said, okay, let me try the music, whether the music will have any impact on him kind of thing. So he took a big veena, and then started playing. He started playing for about 45 minutes, and all of a sudden this West European gentleman, so he fell unconscious and he fell on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
And then afterwards he got up, and then Swamiji realized it worked. Then he said, now your cancer is gone, you go and check anywhere. So he is still alive, that gentleman, after 35 years of age. Since that time, Swamiji has been propagating this healing and meditation music. He
Is there any place, like any common man can go and get those
yes.
bhajans, any
yes.
website?
DallasHanuman.org.
Okay.
DallasHanuman.org. If they go, they can access all these things. In the same way, Amazon, you can go to Amazon, look for all his CDs. Anywhere they are available. And so they are available in our temple also. Anybody who is coming to Hanuman temple, they can buy also. Swamiji has also written almost 200 books. There are at least 400 or 500 CDs, bhajans, and healing.
And they are all available.
Well, available.
Definitely, that access can be definitely, you know, like we will give you again one more time.
Yeah.
The Hanuman. .org.
Yes.
Please do visit that and try to see yourself what Dr. Rao is talking about. And thank you so much for watching, and we'll come back in our next episode. We will explore, as we all know, Kare Siddhi Hanuman Temple is a very prominent part of this Dallas Fort Worth. Let's go explore a little bit about it and learn the importance of it.
Yeah.
So till then, stay tuned. Good evening and welcome back. Thank you so much for joining again, and we'll continue with our conversation with Dr. Prakash Rao on Face to Face. We talked about in our previous episode about the importance of temple and also the mantras and a lot more about Hinduism. So it is time for us to introduce one of the very unique temple that is there in Dallas-Fort Worth area. A lot of you may know about it. And Dr. Prakash Rao is a very big part of it and his involvement in the temple. So it's time for us to find out more. Welcome back. And
thank you.
This is a great opportunity for us and also our audience viewers to know about this great temple.
Yes.
So you are a very prominent part of Kare Siddhi Hanuman Temple here in Dallas-Fort Worth. So we would like to know more about it.
As I mentioned, I think, in the last episode, so in 2007, Sri Ganapati Satchidananda Swamiji expressed his interest based on the desires of the people, devotees, that he is interested in having Hanuman Temple in Dallas. Mm-hmm. By that time, there are already some devotees here.
Okay.
So that way, it becomes easy for them to organize it and assemble the whole thing. So as soon as he expressed his desire, by 2008 January, so we were able to find the land, mm-hmm. 10 acres of land.
Mm-hmm.
And so we went to Frisco City Council to get the approval in January 2008.
Mm-hmm.
So with the blessings of Sri Swamiji, so we bought the 10 acre land. After we bought that one, within 3-4 months, so our Swamiji came actually. By that time, we already started operating as a temple in a small trailer. I think some of you probably, you know,
yes.
And we didn't even have the road, nothing actually. The whole Independence Boulevard now, what we have, there was no proper facilities. There was no construction, there was nothing. So then we started actually in that one.
Mm-hmm.
By that time, we already had what we call the Sunday school. We call it Baladatta.
Mm-hmm.
Even before we have the temple, so it was started actually in Dallas. So then we started continuing that Baladatta Sunday school in that trailer home.
Mm-hmm.
The same year, in sometime in June, July, so there was a groundbreaking ceremony for a 10,000 square foot building, which now is an old building kind of thing. And so then, you know, the installation was done in 2009, and Swamiji came and did the Prana Pratishtha and all that. And so the Hanuman is the main murti in
mm-hmm.
that place.
Mm-hmm.
So then all the activities were going on with the Sunday school. You see, that building has about 7-8 classrooms, just solely for conducting the Sunday school.
So what exactly do we offer in the Sunday schools for students?
Yes. So you see, basically the different groups,
mm-hmm.
because you cannot teach the same thing for all the age groups.
Sure.
So 6 to 7, 8 to 9, 9 to 11,
mm-hmm.
11 to 13. So those are the things.
Mm-hmm.
So we have now 540 students enrolled in it.
Okay.
So depending on the age, so we, our people have actually came up with a curriculum.
Sure. sure.
as to what to teach age. At what age. It could be preliminarily, mm-hmm. even though Bhagavatam you may not, you may teach some things mm-hmm. at the age 5, 6 and 7, but you can also teach at a different level in some. So that is how the, there are language classes, there are music classes, there is bhajan classes, mm-hmm. art classes, drawing classes, you name it, almost so many opportunities are given for our children actually in Hanuman temple. Anybody has any interest or which is related to our Hinduism, our art and what not, if we have enough students, mm-hmm. we are willing to do it. That is how we expanded it, this to have 540 students actually in our Sunday school.
Without any restrictions or anything, that anyone can come and learn and
exactly. So they have to enroll, because now mm-hmm. you cannot actually have even the seats. You need to pre-register. Only then you will be able to open. Mm-hmm. If somebody comes, if they want to enroll, they can. Because we don't want to have more than 22, 23 students in each.
Absolutely.
Each. Even though we may have 6, 7 sections of the same, mm-hmm. but still you don't want to exceed certain number mm-hmm. because you won't have that direct interaction with the kids. Mm-hmm. So that's the reason. So we have that many.
Recently, and also you taught several students a different way of learning Hinduism.
Yeah. You see, then let me go back, so that way I will come to this one. Mm-hmm. And then 2004, mm-hmm. actually our Swamiji did the groundbreaking ceremony for a big temple which you all see now.
Absolutely.
That is the Karisiddhi Hanuman temple.
Yes.
With
beautiful,
Markatha, yeah. with the Markatha Hanuman as the mm-hmm. main idol.
Okay.
And 2015, mm-hmm. so Swamiji actually did the Kumbhabhishekam. Mm-hmm. And so then this is the unique temple. It is probably one of the largest temple, if not the largest temple in the United States. As I said, I have been here for almost 51 years. I have visited so many temples. Mm-hmm. This size of the temple is not there anywhere. Mm-hmm. There may be so many temples with so many buildings, mm-hmm. one for this one, one for that one, but where you can have close to 4,000 people sitting in one place,
right.
and doing puja or watching puja, either Kalyanam or whatever we are doing it. Mm-hmm. So this is unique in that respect. 4,000 people can be
accommodated. I was going to ask you, what is the uniqueness of this, because I've heard a lot about it. And
okay,
so
uniqueness. So let me tell you a few unique things about this temple. You see, we all, ever since new temple has come,
right.
even before, just one, I'll go one step. Swamiji came in 2008, mm-hmm. April. Mm-hmm. That was the time the neighborhoods were just opened up at that time.
Okay.
Okay. That is on the south side. Mm-hmm. Swamiji immediately said all the devotees should go ahead and buy all these lots and then build houses. Because so that way there will be less confusion among people also, mm-hmm. other religious people they may have. So as a result, all the houses touching our property on the south, they are all devotees.
Okay.
So in the same way on the east side also. Mm-hmm. Okay. That is one. Now, of course, now the north side also, mm-hmm. all the houses came, mm-hmm. and then as a result, mm-hmm. they are also devotees. Now, we call this one as an Agraharam. Mm-hmm. Okay. In olden days, and some people may have seen Agraharam, I don't think many people have seen Agraharam. Agraharam means generally you will see a lake, mm-hmm. and then with steps and all that, and then there will be a temple, mm-hmm. and most of the people used to stay around it. Okay. And at the same time, when you have a temple, you will see a row of houses on one side and the row of houses on the other side, and then on the back also. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, exactly the same situation you will see. We have houses on the south side of the temple, west, north side, mm-hmm. and then on the east side also. Okay. So, Agra Haram. Haram means garland. As if you have put a garland to the temple with the devotees. Devotees as petals.
Okay. Oh, wow.
Or the flowers.
That's awesome.
So, I don't think there is any place like this one over the last 200 years. Even in India now, they cannot do something like this one.
Right.
This is the blessing, this is the vision of Ganapati Satchidananda Swamiji.
Wow.
That is one uniqueness. Agraharam is mm-hmm. the concept. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at these three temples, mm-hmm. the two, and you will see those three mm-hmm. gopurams. And mm-hmm. these are actually, we brought 30 shilpis from India, and then we built this one, and then we bought a special painter mm-hmm. actually who did lot of research on India, who has done some painting in other states. We brought that gentleman to make sure this particular temple okay. will reflect and then make okay. sure it will show up.
Got it.
Because each god has their own colors.
Sure.
Like if you look at our Durga Devi, mm-hmm. it is gold color.
Right.
Because ladies, obviously, it is gold color. In the same way, Shiva, if you see so many different colors, at least 10 different colors.
Mm-hmm.
Why 10 different colors? If you remember, there is a mythological story where Shiva was to be waken up by Kamadhenu.
Right.
And at that time, he created the whole atmosphere to look like a spring right. atmosphere.
Sure.
Whatever colors we think that are used at that time, so those are the colors that we put.
Wonderful.
Like that one. So those, and then if you stand in front of Hanuman temple,
mm-hmm.
so you can see all the three gopurams.
Okay.
Okay, from inside itself you can see all three gopurams.
Mm-hmm.
And then you will also see on the back of the temple, that means to the east side, there is a circular window.
Mm-hmm.
So once we have Rajagopuram, mm-hmm. you can stand right there and you can also see the Rajagopuram itself.
That.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
that is the another uniqueness of the temple.
Okay.
And then Markata Hanuman itself is unique.
Mm-hmm.
Nowhere in the world you will find a 5 feet
wow.
Markata Hanuman temple.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a big story to this one also.
Okay.
Swamiji mm-hmm. wanted to have a Markata Hanuman mm-hmm. here. So he used to have a Muslim devotee.
Mm-hmm.
So he used to have a quiry.
Mm-hmm.
And so he completed all that one. So he thought there was nothing
okay.
in that one.
Mm-hmm.
And then he comes to Swamiji, and then Swamiji says, I need this one, and go and find it. He goes for a year, and then he comes back. Swamiji, I can't find anything like this one.
Mm-hmm.
Then Swamiji says, wherever you stopped your quiry, mm-hmm. you just deep down,
mm-hmm.
you will find it. That is how they found it.
Oh, wow.
So out of that one, there are about 8-9 different murtis are actually chiseled. And two of them, Hanuman.
Mm-hmm.
One is in Hyderabad, and the second one is right here in Dallas.
Just
5 feet. Mm-hmm. Nowhere else you will find anywhere like this one except
wow.
these two Hanuman
wow.
Hanuman idols made of this Markata, that is jade.
Right.
Now, so many other activities. After we build this one,
mm-hmm.
thousands and thousands of people are coming and then just experiencing the divine mm-hmm. divine energy in that one.
Sure.
Swamiji was here at the time of inauguration, mm-hmm. Kumbhabhishekam, for 49 days. Nowhere in his life actually
he stayed that long.
In one place, all 49 days he spent nights right here.
That's
okay?
Wonderful.
So as a result, there are so many vibrations are created. I mean, I'll tell you a couple of people. Just one lady came from Hyderabad. The mm-hmm. minute she entered the building, she started crying.
Mm-hmm.
I said, there must be some problem. I mean, maybe I can
it's
help.
Gone.
And I went and talked to her. She couldn't talk. After a couple of minutes, she comes and says, I never experienced anything like this one. This is the first temple where my goosebumps and everything else, I started crying because there are so much,
mm-hmm.
there is so much energy.
Mm-hmm.
In the same way, the other gentleman, Dr. Subramanian Swami, he also came and he said this is going to be the pilgrimage center for the entire in the Thanikkal Bharani.
Mm-hmm.
So he was giving a lecture
mm-hmm.
in our temple.
Okay.
And then he gave for about 45 minutes and then 1 hour.
Mm-hmm.
And then he started singing. In the meanwhile, he at least mentioned 5-6 times.
Okay.
The vibrations are so strong.
Sure.
Whatever I am doing, whatever I am saying, whatever I am singing,
mm-hmm.
it is not me.
It is
the vibrations that are making me,
come
out of it.
Okay.
And then after he sang one song, he just choked, he cried, he stopped. I said, I can't take this energy, these vibrations. So he stopped it because he could not talk. The vibrations were so strong. That is the importance and significance of our Guruji, who spent 49 days, left all the vibrations, and every year he is coming in order to make sure those vibrations are recreated so that people, when they come, they will experience, wow, experience that one.
That's amazing.
And so, as I said, actually in December, we had 400 students, 400 students, Centennial School, 9th grade students came for 2 days, each class. So there was a class at 9 o'clock, 11 o'clock, 3 o'clock, and so, so we had that. So that is 2 days, they came, 400 students.
Wow.
We talked, we showed the temple, we talked about the significance of all the gopurams and everything else. And then we spent about 40 minutes with each group talking about the importance and the significance and the uniqueness of our salient features of Hinduism.
Right.
Everybody really liked it, everybody appreciated, because we don't force anybody to follow us.
Yes.
We don't force anybody,
absolutely,
to believe in anything.
True.
We say it is the freedom is the only one that matters, and
the
then tolerance, ahimsa, and then how scientific our religion is all about.
Absolutely.
So as a result, so you know, people who come with some phobia or some kind of reservations, oh, they don't convert people, they don't talk about their God, they don't talk about this many things. So I'm free, actually.
That come is the and experience the energy.
Exactly.
Right.
So as a result, actually last, only this month, there is, I think all of us know, there is Austin College in Sherman.
Sure.
And there is a lady by the name Yvette Vargas O'Brien. She is an associate professor of religious studies. She brought so many students before, and those students not only just learned little thing about our religion, they also participate in Bathkamma festival and Diwali
festival,
Navaratri festival. They experience, they didn't have to come.
Correct.
They saw the presentation, they could go, but they said no, they want to stay and see. They even danced, actually
participated in,
exactly,
that event.
So after that experience, so actually she approached and said, you see, I want our students to know the diversity of our Hindu religion.
Correct.
Then I sat with her and then developed the curriculum. So I thought we will just talk about first what is Hinduism, what is the uniqueness, what are the salient factors. That is one lecture. The second lecture would be mythology and symbolism of different gods and goddesses.
Sure.
We had to restrict only to the gods and goddesses in our temple, because we have 330 million gods. We can't talk about all those gods. We selected those ones. So that is another session. And then, so I also mentioned, you need to know a little bit about how we really conduct our worship services, which we call puja.
Cut.
She said, fine, you got it. So we actually asked our priest to do Shodashopachara puja to Lord Hanuman.
Okay.
That means 16 steps.
Sure.
And we need to do the sankalpa, and then what are the steps, how do we do, what is the meaning of all these 16 steps.
Okay.
So we explained in English all these things, and so they were very appreciated. They even asked, why you offer flowers, why you do these things. You see, for all the things that we offer to God, flower is the only one that it would not hurt him. It is so soft. If you, even if you put a leaf, you know, there is a chance it might hurt.
Right.
Whereas a flower, it is so delicate, it won't. In the same way, when we ring the bell, we mentioned about it. Why do we ring the bell? Why do we do arati? These are some of the things they wanted to know. They are curious about it. And so all these things, basically there is a karma theory involved in it. And then why we ring the bell, in order to dispel whatever the negative elements in that one. Because in the whole atmosphere, you have positive as well as negative things all the time.
Sure.
If you look at our scriptures, not only gods, we have equal number of demons also.
Sure.
So that means there is always the competition or contrast between good and evil.
Yes, that's right.
So then the other course is about the dance programs.
Okay.
So we requested, actually Sri Lalita Suri to come and demonstrate different poses and what dance is all about. And then what about the different Navrasas? And she gave a presentation about the dances. And then we also talked about Guru Tattva. Why do we need a Guru? What are the features of the Guru? How do we recognize a Guru? Who is Lord Dattatreya? And what are the characteristics? Do we need really Guru? You know, if you look at all the gods, gods have Gurus. It's not just only human beings. Yeah, all the saints have Gurus.
Right.
All the Gurus have Gurus. So as ordinary human beings,
we don't.
Because you see, nobody taught us about anything. We only developed some negative attitude the way I developed. Most of us have those kinds of
things. I think you're a good example that, you know, one should know how we should get into that and then what led you to the spiritual life. Let's learn more about in our next episode. And this was a wonderful information. And you must visit Karasiddhi Hanuman Temple to just witness yourself what Dr. Prakash Rao is talking about, because this is one of the most beautiful temple in Frisco that's located in Dallas-Fort Worth area. So thank you so much for watching. And we will talk more about other information about Hinduism in our next episode. Stay tuned. Welcome back. Thank you so much for watching Desi Plaza TV. And this is Face to Face with Dr. Prakash Rao. We are continuing with the next episode. So far, we talked in our previous episodes the importance of Hinduism and his involvement in the spiritual life and also what he is doing to spread the word about Hinduism. So let's continue and ask his involvement, what he is doing globally to spread this word. So Dr. Prakash Rao, welcome back.
Thank you.
Let's talk a little bit about the organization that you are involved, the GHHF, the Global Hindu Heritage Foundation,
correct,
which is one of the most prominent organization that is helping the Hinduism, importance of Hinduism.
Correct.
So tell us a little bit about it.
You see, in 2006, I retired from the university. So I thought I will just take it easy and go and visit all the places in India, and then so I don't have to worry about after so many years of whatever struggle or whatever you want to call it. So I went to India and I was staying with my brother. That was August 23rd, 2006, 7:23 minutes. I was reading Eenadu, that's a Telugu paper, where I saw a news item whereby the then chief minister issued GO 21, by which he allocated crores of rupees for the construction of new churches and renovation of old churches. So when I read that piece, my blood boiled. I mean, I couldn't take it. I was literally shivering, actually shaking, because the Hinduism is the root of India. Annie Besant actually said, if there is no Hinduism, there is no India. If the Hinduism is pulled out of India, there is no India, there is no global harmony. Okay. So then what do I do? I was so angry. I called so many people to see what can be done. I couldn't get the answer. Finally, I talked to a couple of lawyers. And then within a week, I filed a case actually in the High Court to see if it can be stopped. So we were able to get stay order to release those funds. So we were successful at that time. And then I came to the US with some of our friends. So we started this Global Hindu Heritage Foundation.
So you are the founder of?
Yes, one of the two, three founders.
Okay.
Now, why did we start? Mm-hmm. What is the purpose of this organization?
Absolutely.
Is the basic
sure.
question anybody would ask.
Okay.
The reason we started this one is, how do we preserve our Hinduism? How do we protect our temples?
Heritage.
Because when we start reading about it, mm-hmm. all the government, all the temples in India, most of the temples in India are taken over by the state governments.
Okay.
So, which is true of all the southern states,
you
know, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Kerala.
Mm.
So, Andhra Pradesh also same thing. There are 38,000 temples are taken over by any temple that makes 50 lakh rupees or more automatically goes under the government control. But it is not the same with other religions.
Okay.
The churches are independent, mosques are independent. Why the government would not take those and then control them?
Correct.
Or run them.
Right.
So then you keep thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
Then you wonder why we have to allow the government to run our temples.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then not only that one, in 2008, 20% of the temple lands were sold by the government.
Okay.
As if they have the right, which they think they claim they have the right. Some people probably 2,200 years, 300,000 years ago, they built the temple with all the vision that they have. They wanted to make sure these temples continue to run after they leave. They donated this much land, make sure these temples will be maintained properly. It is that kind of vision they had. And these government officials, all these politicians, they are abusing the system. They are destroying the temples, they are destroying the Hinduism. Whether they know it or not, for their selfish reasons, for their power, for their fame, they are demeaning the Hinduism, destroying the Hindu temples. This is the reason why we started this global Hindu Heritage.
In order to
make sure, because they are able to take it because there is a law which is called Endowment Act. Endowment, so that's the reason all these states have endowment departments. There is a minister for the endowment department for all the states also. So they run these temples. Okay, what authority do they have? Except they just want to have the power and they took over. So the problem with our Hindus is we are just so ignorant, we are indifferent, we are silent, we don't care a hoot for anything that happens to our Hinduism. Because even if there is a temple that you go every day, and if that temple is closed, what do you think you will say? Most likely I'll say, well, I'll go to some other temple. We won't ask a single question why this temple is closed today. We have become so selfish. What is it in for me? If I get something, I will go. If I don't, I don't give anything to this temple. So this is the mindset that is destroying our Hinduism. That is the reason all the other religions are encroaching and then trying to prevail on us. In addition to that one, our Hindu leaders have become so selfish, they are the ones who are actually buying all these temple lands, encroaching the temple lands and then trying to basically affect the maintenance of these temples. When we looked at all the at least 30-35% of the temple lands are sold now.
Okay.
If you look at all the people who bought it or who encroached it, they are all Hindus.
What about the ones that we already have, like, you know, that were like came as a you know, already from our ancestors, like, you know, so many kings and queens they already built, like, so do you think at least they are given importance to
No, they don't give anything. In fact, you see, in Kalahasti there is a Rajagopuram that was built by one of the kings, I am forgetting the name. So, a 500 year old temple, okay. Rajagopuram collapsed, okay, 2 years ago. Sri Krishna Devarayal built that one. Now there is no history. And so there is a tug of war, there is always division. You have archaeology department, they have to approve it, and the endowment department will write a letter. There is no stipulation as to how much time they will take in order to respond. If you write a letter, tell me one government official giving any response to you.
It's unfortunate.
They think they are supreme, they are gods, they are beyond gods. This is the kind of mindset that they have today. So anyway, the point is, our mission is to see that Endowment Act is repealed. So as a result, so we have done lot of things. We have circulated a lot of information about it. We are associated with Dr. Subramanya Swami. We are also associated with Paripurnananda Swami and many other Swamijis. We also met and then discussed with Ravi Shankar, Ganapati Satchidananda Swamiji, all of them. Mm-hmm. So they are aware of actually what we are doing, and we have their blessings. Dayananda Saraswati, mm-hmm. about 3.5 years ago, so collected information about 2,500 temples. In terms of how much abuse there is in terms of the resources, in terms of the money, in terms of the lands, in terms of jewelry, how the mm-hmm. temples are destroying all these things. So he collected all that information through Right to Information Act and filed a case in the Supreme Court, basically to see that this Endowment Act is repealed, mm-hmm. scrapped. Mm-hmm. So that way Hindus can take over their own temples and run whichever they want to run. See, if it is my house, let me run the way I want to run it.
Got it.
If I want to destroy myself, that is fine. Mm-hmm. But who are you to run this temple?
Absolutely.
You have no right, mm-hmm. except you are taking advantage of the benevolence and then ahimsa of the Hindus.
Got it.
This is what is happening in India, and people are not realizing. Everybody who looks at it or who watches also, they feel, oh, we need to do it, but that's the end of it, they won't do it. It is apathy of our Hindus is the one that is causing major drawback actually in our thinking.
It's a great thing that this organization exists, and through this organization we were talking about the activities. So what type of things that it's doing to bring
Correct.
That awareness?
Correct. Okay. So now it is in Supreme Court. Uh-huh. Dr. Subramanya Swami is defending the case. It already came up in next
okay.
2 years. Mm-hmm. We are hoping that it will be repealed.
Okay.
Once it is repealed, then we have to manage the temples.
Sure.
So our Global Hindu Heritage Foundation has already hired 2 people mm-hmm. to write a constitution for the management of Hindu temples.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be used in order to mm-hmm. how to run the temples.
Sure.
That is one. And then we have started an office about 3.5 years ago in mm-hmm. Hyderabad to monitor what is happening in Andhra Pradesh. And everything depends on the resources. You know, you can have any office okay. anywhere, but
Correct.
Because. So as a result, we have only mm-hmm. that one.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so in 2013, we brought actually the endowment minister from Andhra Pradesh.
Mm-hmm.
We had a conference here in Dallas.
Okay.
We submitted 100 recommendations.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, there is no way I can do all of these things.
Mm-hmm.
You tell me one thing what you want. We said, make sure that no temple lands are sold.
Mm-hmm.
He said he will do it. Mm-hmm. Within 6 months, he was able to bring GO, that means government order, call it, by which now they cannot sell the temple lands. Okay, so that way at least we have been successful to some extent about that one. In the same way, so we also requested government 2 other things. One is, so we wanted to have the aarti to all the rivers.
Mm-hmm.
So that way the people will go just the way they do it in Varanasi
right.
every day.
Mm-hmm.
So we also asked that one, we got a GO,
mm-hmm.
and then so they are doing Nadula aarti every time in Kartik Masam.
Mm-hmm.
And this year, in April, this mm-hmm. year means 2016, April, we wrote a letter
mm-hmm.
to the Endowment Minister asking mm-hmm. that Krishna Janmashtami should be declared as Go Dinotsava Puja Day.
Mm-hmm.
That means everybody, all the temples have to do Go Puja
mm-hmm.
on Krishna Janmashtami,
okay.
which they have issued GO
mm-hmm.
recognizing on the recommendation of Global Hindu Heritage Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
So we are doing this one. And then we are also involved in the Vakala Mata temple.
Mm-hmm.
So Vakala Mata temple actually is about 5 kilometers or 6 kilometers from the Balaji temple.
Mm-hmm.
It used to operate
in Tirupati. Okay.
And about 100 years ago, according to the villagers,
mm-hmm.
Muslims actually destroyed it and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And then since that time, there was no action. And that particular mountain is being illegally mined by different people. When we saw it, we were exhausted.
Mm-hmm.
And so then we took up this issue, and Dr. Paripurna Swami Garu was involved in it,
mm-hmm.
and Ghazal Srinivas was involved in it. That is, then there is Bhan Prakash Reddy now, who became TTD trustee member.
Right.
He is also involved in it. We were all walking on the streets in Tirupati at one time or the other to see that this temple is built. In fact, some Paripurnan Swami even pledged, mm-hmm. he promised mm-hmm. that he is not going to visit the Balaji temple, Balaji Darshan, until Vakala Mata temple is completed.
Okay.
So now, last November, mm-hmm. so the High Court actually cleared all the things. Mm-hmm. So now, hopefully, we are planning to have some groundbreaking ceremony in February itself for the Vakala Mata temple.
Dr. tell me, when you said that, okay, these temple that you already are doing so much about and bringing the awareness, is this only in India, or is this, for example, if someone buy this one globally, like other than any country than India, also that you are also, you know, working towards those?
Only in terms of the activities, we are not. Mm-hmm. But suppose you see Russia, at one time they wanted to ban Bhagavad Gita.
Right.
So we took up that issue, we corresponded that
way.
So this correspondence and then activism, sending the petitions, communicating with them is all we can do. Physically we are doing and all those things, we don't have the resources. We are only concentrated in Andhra and Telangana.
Right.
So in the same way, so we'll mention just a few things what we have done.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the most of the temples, they are under government control. They don't do any Kumbhabhishekam. So according to our scriptures, every 12 years
mm-hmm.
you have to do Kumbhabhishekam.
Mm-hmm.
That means you have to re-energize the temple. You have to infuse more energy, more life into the murtis and all those things.
Mm-hmm.
They never did that one.
Mm-hmm.
So last year we have taken up one temple
mm-hmm.
in Palkollu. There is a Ramalingeshwara Swami temple.
Mm-hmm.
So we got the permission, because you have to get the permission of the government. You can't touch anything.
Right.
So at least they gave a permission. Mm-hmm. As a result, so we have done the Kumbhabhishekam to that Ramalingeshwara temple
mm-hmm.
in Palkollu last year.
Mm-hmm.
3 days, lot of expenses. So Global Hindu Heritage Foundation was able to fund it.
Mm-hmm.
And then Dr. Ghazal Srinivas was the one instrumental in organizing the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
After we completed that one, all the major temples are approaching us, why don't you do it for us, why don't you do it? But the government doesn't have a sense to say this, every 12 years we are supposed to do it. They are only in money making.
Mm.
Tirupati gets so much money, Tirupati money itself probably can take care of all the things that we are talking about it.
Mm-hmm.
But they will use it for other purposes.
Mm-hmm.
Like 2 weeks ago, Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister mentioned that he was going to give 500 crores for the Christians. Why?
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the argument is we also give it to the Hindu causes.
Right.
But you are giving Hindu causes because you are taking money from the Hindu temples
mm-hmm.
and you are giving it back.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas for other religions, they are not giving anything to you,
mm-hmm.
but you are subsidizing, you are promoting the other religions,
mm-hmm.
either directly or indirectly, you are suppressing Hinduism,
mm-hmm.
you are promoting the other religions.
Well, I think more than promoting other religions, I think the money should be used for the purpose it is supposed to be used.
Exactly.
Probably that is what I feel, because I think you're right.
Yeah.
No,
absolutely. It should be used only for that.
Mm-hmm.
Then if they are not using it, what is the intent?
Correct.
Obviously, they have some other interest.
I think so.
Okay.
So that
interest should be put aside and
mm-hmm.
see this money is only for the purpose it is intended for. That is all we are asking.
Mm-hmm.
In the same way,
mm-hmm.
so our Ghazal Srinivas, who is our ambassador, who
mm-hmm.
takes care of our office in Hyderabad,
mm-hmm.
so he actually done lot of other things also.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know the Suprabhatam, like Venkateshwara Balaji Suprabhatam, like
mm-hmm.
this one. So at least 6 different temples have asked us to come up with Suprabhatam.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So the Ramalingeshwara temple, and then there is one Panakala Swami temple in Guntur,
mm-hmm.
Mangalagiri, there is one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you heard of it, it's a very famous temple.
Mm-hmm.
Like that one, so he composed, he sang
mm-hmm.
and the Suprabhatam to many temples.
Okay.
So that is one of the things. In the same way, we have taken up the Gomata as a cause
mm-hmm.
and we have written, we have corresponded with the Prime Minister and other people also to make sure that the beef is not exported.
Absolutely.
Even though it is doing it. But we are expressing our outrage
mm-hmm.
about what is happening to our we have donated.
So you are basically taking it back and restoring and also preserving our culture and heritage.
Then advocating the principles of Hinduism and what is good for our culture and all that.
Absolutely.
We have donated a lot of money for number of goshalas, at least 15, 16 goshalas also. If anybody is interested, they can sponsor a go. One cow per year, it is about $500. They can select their own goshala, or we can select, we can let you know whom we are.
So before we even take the further thing, so is there any information or a website that our viewers can reach out if they want to know more about this Global Heritage, Hindu Heritage Foundation?
Yes, so we have a website, Save Temples.
Okay.
Very simple. Save temples. Plural. SaveTemples.org. So if you look at that one, so I have written probably about 140, 150 articles. Mm-hmm. You can access all those articles in the website, all the activities. And so every yearly activities, you will all be able to see it also.
Well, thank you so much for giving very, you know, extensive knowledge about this Global Hindu Heritage Foundation that is promoting the Hinduism, and also giving a very vast knowledge about what it is and, you know, what is followed in it. And definitely this is something that we again revisit and explore more.
Okay.
So thank you so much for watching, and we will come back in the next episode to give you more about Hinduism. And thank you to Dr. Prakash Rao for giving us such a great information. Stay tuned. We'll be back.
Thank you.
Hello, Dallas, and thank you for watching Desi Plaza TV. And this is Anu. And today we have face-to-face Dr. Prakash Rao in the studio. And I have a very important question for him that probably we all must know. And he is a prominent teacher and really a great scholar in learning or teaching Hinduism. And we learned so many things from him, whether it is regarding why we chant mantra or what are the strict ways that and how we follow the Hinduism. He has extensive knowledge about Hinduism. And recently, I think one of the events that we need to talk about is a petition against TV9. Dr. Prakash Rao, welcome, and thank you
so much
for joining.
Thank you.
And today's question for you is, recently you have filed a petition against TV9.
Yes.
So we would like to know what happened. What is it that we want to know about?
Yeah, this is a very interesting episode in our Hindu life. About a week ago, there is a highly eminent speaker, scholar, Sri Chaganti Koteswarrao Garu. He was giving a lecture on Lord Krishna. And he was giving that lecture, and in that one, so he mentioned some Telugu word by which he says, because Lord Krishna comes from Yadav community.
Mm-hmm.
So he made a statement, basically it can be interpreted either way, okay? In a sense, if they wash their feet, they may not be able to wash the bottom. If they wash the bottom, they may not be able to wash the face, something to that effect. And from that particular community, all the Yadava communities have grown and then protected the cows. They pasteurized the cows, and then the Krishna came into existence, and he became the leader, and he became the Jagat Guru of the entire universe. So his intention in that one was, basically, he came from such an innocent community, from that age, who is loving, who has compassion, and from that particular community, he has grown up all the way to Jagat Guru. So he wanted to mention that particular thing rather than anything else. Because sometimes what happens, whenever we like somebody, sometimes we use somewhat what we call abusive words. In Telugu, so we will say, if somebody is doing real great job and good job, adi pichodu eppudu chestuntadu antam. Pichodu ante, he is a madman.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, if you take that one literally, and see, you call them madman,
mm-hmm.
is that what you are saying?
Mm-hmm.
So this is how the TV9 has interpreted,
mm-hmm.
and then started just sending this one almost several times a day. The following day itself, that is Jagante Koteswara Garu, so he apologized. About 8 or 9 Yadav community leaders went to his house, and then he apologized. He did not mean it, because you see what his intention was. From such an innocent group of people, the Lord has born and he became Jagadguru. It was that intention rather than anything else. But these people have twisted the whole thing. Now, after you give an apology, at least you should stop showing. Maybe one time, that's fine. Two times, that's fine. Four times, that's fine. But every day they keep on showing several times to provoke Hindus, mm-hmm. create hatredness,
sure.
foment some kind of animosity among Hindus itself.
Sure.
So that is the target of TV9.
Okay.
Because I have seen 4 or 5 years ago, mm-hmm. he showed so many negative things about different Swamijis.
Sure.
But he never showed a single thing about either Muslims or the Christians.
Sure.
So that means they are above all these things.
Mm-hmm.
Is this what TV9 thinks?
Correct.
Okay. So our point is, so they should have stopped right after he gave the apology.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of that one, they kept on showing it in order to create more animosity among themselves.
So then misinterpreting and misguiding,
twisted the whole meaning of
sure.
that one. Okay.
Okay.
Now, if you have done that many times, let us say 50 times, whatever they have shown,
mm-hmm.
but did you show the same thing when some other things happened? Like, I will give you 3 examples.
Mm-hmm.
About a week ago, mm-hmm. one mullah actually declared a fatwa against Narendra Modi, who is the Prime Minister of India, saying if anybody blacken his face and then shave his beard, he will give 25 lakh rupees. Did they ever show anything? We are talking about the Prime Minister,
the
head
the
of the country.
Of country.
Did
right.
they show even once? Did
Correct.
They say anything about that one? Did they criticize the mullah mm-hmm. who did it?
Mm-hmm.
They are all scared of these people. There is, in fact, I would say mm-hmm. there is a death of dialogue and freedom in India now. You can't talk about religion. You can't talk about your community. You can't talk about anything. Because everybody claims it is a secular country. When it is a secular country, then why you give all the incentives to all these minorities? Why you pump all the money to these people?
What about the freedom of speech?
Freedom of speech is not there. Even only yesterday, the election commissioner said nobody should be talking about religion. Nobody should be talking about the caste system when you are campaigning. Here, if we have look at our elections in the United States, the Trump openly says, I am going to destroy the ISIS, no matter where they are. Tell me one person who can say anything like that one in India.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have freedom.
Mm-hmm.
This secular concept, the appeasement of the minorities, is destroying India.
Mm-hmm.
So I will give you another example why I am saying. So he showed so many times
mm-hmm.
in order to antagonize the Hindus. So, why did they say anything about this mullah who actually declared fatwa against a prime minister? In the same way, there is a gentleman by the name Akbaruddin Owaisi from Hyderabad itself. So, he said, remove police for 15 minutes. We will kill 100 crore Hindus. Okay?
Openly.
Where is this TV channel 9 and other channels? Did they ever say anything about it?
Mm-hmm.
How often did they say? Did they compare these things to this one?
Do we know why they are protecting or why they are avoiding this?
It's very simple. They are scared.
Okay.
They can't open it. They cannot open their mouth.
Mm-hmm.
They are at their peril, actually. So everything is dominated by other religions.
Mm-hmm.
No government is able to openly talk about all the atrocities the other communities are doing it. Like the way the Trump mentioned,
mm-hmm.
tell me one politician who can do it.
So you're saying that you should be bold enough, you
have to. And
right.
in the same way, there is one Elaya, you know, Kanchan Elaya professor. So he even demeaned Lord Krishna,
mm-hmm.
saying he is, you know, a sexual pervert, and then he is not even Yadav community, all kinds of things.
Correct.
But did they ever show all these things?
No.
How often did they show? This one they have showed probably 50, 60 times. Did they ever show at least 3-4 times any of these things?
You don't think any personal agenda is involved in this one for just a particular?
You see, this is like what is called yellow journalism.
Okay.
They are only interested in money, money, money.
Okay.
There is no, even though their websites talk about the integrity, credibility, unbiased opinion. Tell me, even a blind person can see what they are saying.
Correct.
A dumb can hear what they are talking about.
Right.
See, they have crew. They are only interested in the money. Mm-hmm. They are in that in a glass domes, and that's all they want to. As long as they are making money, as long as they can find something to antagonize Hindus, they are ready to do it. But the end result is, once they destroy Hinduism, where do they go from?
Correct.
Their existence is in peril.
Correct.
They don't realize it. But what they think, they are only interested in the right now, how much money we will make. That's
so
all they are interested.
What do you think they should do to just, you know, even to get this one fixed, or even, what is your message? What is your suggestion?
My message is very simple. It is, you need to have some soul searching in your own self. What am I doing showing 50 times about this thing? Why I am showing 50 times? Why I am not showing 50 times about the mullah who declared fatwa against Prime Minister?
Why only this should be shown this and not that one? Then, so if you want to bring both.
And then Vavasi, when he says he can kill 100 crores of Hindus.
Correct.
Where is this channel? Why it is not talking openly about this one?
Correct.
And so you may talk one or two times, but why not 50 times the way you said? Just for one single statement,
correct,
an innocent statement, and they have twisted the whole meaning of that sentence and then started bombarding and then trying to create the animosity in order to see that the Hinduism is destroyed. That is their goal.
Correct.
That's the reason we sent this petition saying that this is a twisted statement. They are abusing the whole system.
Okay.
They are abusing their freedom of press. They are abusing that unbiased reporting. So somebody has to be accountable for it.
Correct.
And even the governments don't interfere with these things, which it doesn't understand. I don't understand this logic.
Probably that is a very small issue, that is what is considered as, and then maybe that was ignored completely.
But you see, when you look at the election commission saying you can't talk about religion and then caste, then why can't they say that you can't show this many things, you cannot antagonize it?
Correct.
And you see, freedom of press, we agree, but there is also limit.
Right.
There is responsibility that goes with it.
Correct.
There is morality that goes with it. There is integrity that goes with it.
Mm-hmm.
There is credibility that goes with it. Where is it? So you are your own judge.
Mm.
You make your own decision. You decide what is right. Who else? No other person.
No one is involved in this
But nobody is able to even get to them or talk to them or suggest.
Right.
There is no independent organization even to assess what is wrong, what is right, how we can improve it.
But it is really great to know, Dr. Rao, that you came forward, took the first step to do something about it instead of just, you know, sitting. And thank you so much for sharing this information with our viewers. And hopefully you will definitely get the right answer and all the things will go in the right direction. Thank you so much for watching. And if you have any questions, definitely you can reach us. And is there any website or anything that if they have a questions or any support that
they want to give? Call me. They can just go to our website, savetemples.org. And if they have any questions, they can just send their questions. So I'll be happy to answer whatever questions they may have.
Well, thank you so much for watching Face to Face with Dr. Prakash Rao. We'll bring some more information in our next episode. Thank you for joining.
Thank you.
Stay tuned.